Good morning, everyone. I'm John Handy, Communications Director for the House Republican Caucus, and I'd like to welcome you to our Republican media availability today. With us on the House side are leader Representative J.T. Wilcox from the 2nd District, floor leader Representative Jacqueline Maycumber of the 7th District, and Representative Andrew Barkus from the 2nd District. And from the Senate, we have today leader John Braun from the 20th District, Caucus Chair Judy Warnick of the 13th District, and floor leader Shelley Short of the 7th District. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Leader Wilcox for some remarks. Unmute. If you could unmute yourself, Representative Wilcox.
Well, thank you very much. I guess we're not getting quite as much practice in Zoom this year as we did last year. But thank you, everybody, for being on. Very much appreciate it. Believe it or not, we're 15% through this session, maybe even a little more than that. And we're starting to see, I think, some very substantive things happen. And I also think that what we're seeing is all five corners doing their best to get back into a legislature the way that it was designed to work, people collaborating, people working on things that are common to both sides. We know that there's going to be ideology and there's some quarrelsome fights coming up, but I think that there is also the sense that we're here to accomplish things that are good for everybody whenever that's possible to do. We've got some interesting bills being heard this week. Especially ones having to do with school resource officers and school safety. We've got dual credit access by Drew Stokesbury, and we have a great deal of work, including my two colleagues here, around workforce and around housing. And I'm sure that we will get to those, but I will hand off to my friend and colleague from the Senate first, Senator John Braun.
Well, thank you, JT. I think JT covered where we're at. Third week of session. This is about the time where things get a little bit difficult as some of the more challenging bills start to come up. But we are continuing to focus on doing the right things for the people of the state of Washington, continue to focus on what we believe are the top issues, public safety, working the Blake decision, working the pursuit issue, working to provide more law enforcement officers in our communities around the state, working on affordability, the food, gas, housing, childcare. Housing in particular is, I think, where we have the most opportunity. And I think we'll have some discussion about that here today. And then on education, and we're working hard on how do we get our children back on track from the learning loss they suffered during the pandemic, and how do we make sure the long-term structure of funding for our K-12 public education system is sound and in accordance with our constitutional responsibilities. So these are the top issues, but lots of other things going on: environment, energy, transportation, homelessness, you name it. We're working on it here in Olympia, and we look forward to answering your questions.
Okay, with that, we will go to questions. First, I'd like to call on Jerry Cornfield of the Daily Herald.
I guess my example wasn't helpful for Jerry.
All right. You missed the best part for our crowds at home. But let me just start on transportation. Tomorrow there is the governor and Democratic senators are holding a press conference about transportation safety. I thought that was a bipartisan issue. I wondered if you could comment. There's been a slew of bills and there's a budget. What are the priorities for your caucus, and what are maybe if there's any bills out there that are concerning to your caucuses on transportation safety?
Well, I'm glad to have included our transportation lead, Representative Andrew Barkus, for that question.
Great. Good morning. Thank you, Representative Wilcox. Jerry, it's good to hear from you. Yes, I'm hoping to be able to attend that tomorrow, both my colleague and also Senator King. Firmly believe and agree with our other colleagues that safety is a priority for our state. There are many things that are being talked about. And I think where we might see some divergence in our opinions on how to attack this, it's more than just putting cameras up in work zones. That is one tool to use. It's a policy that you're going to hear about. Work zone safety is paramount. We want to make sure every worker on our highways is afforded the most, you know, every measure that we can do. But I think you'll hear from our caucuses the very much the emphasis put on the fact that we have seen a reduction in our state trooper forces on our roads over the last several years in numbers that are directly in correlation why we're seeing this spike in accidents, fatalities, and the like. So our emphasis is going to be through the budget work and so forth to make sure that that is an integral part of any proposal talking about safety on our highways. So there are other bills that are being talked about. We're going to talk about my next meeting is with the State Patrol. How do we better protect our tow truck drivers and those that are on the roads providing these services with our first responders? Bill's talking about the type of lights and colors they can use. This came up last year, a little more controversial than I thought it was going to be. I couldn't believe how many people hold to the color of lights that they get to use. But we need to look at that and many other things that have to do with policies that we can get at to assure safety, both for those that are working on our highways and those that are traveling our highways. I would also add, I think, making sure that we're cleaning up these right-of-ways of these homeless encampments. I think that one of the biggest detractors and safety concerns is people on the right-of-ways living, the garbage that is spilling under our highways. I had a person tell me the other day that a tire rolled out from one of these camps right in front of their car. They swerved, almost hit another car. There's another accident that could have been avoided if we would take the steps necessary. And so I'm going to be really pushing that we actually make some strides in getting that done.
I'll just jump in. I talked to Curtis King about this just the other day, and they did invite him to participate. There wasn't a lot of advanced knowledge as far as what the topics were. So I appreciate that they're being a little bit more bipartisan. I'm not sure it's full partnership at this point, but we're making steps in that direction. I would just add, in addition to the items that Representative Barkas brought up, a simple investment in capacity, both for the State Patrol, but also just in freeway capacity makes a big difference in terms of safety. We continue to underinvest in capacity for our freeway systems. We continue to underinvest in maintenance of those systems. And those items all have a significant impact on congestion and safety on the road. So this is a broad topic. And certainly we want to pursue the things that keep workplaces, you know, the work areas safe. That's important. But there's a lot more to it than just doing that.
Jerry, did you have a follow-up?
I'll just stay on the topic because just something Senator Braun, you just said, and I'm wondered. Last session, transportation was a partisan issue. Yes. And they pushed through a $17 billion package without any much conversation and no votes from your caucuses. Is it better this session, or is it already, is this press conference, is this a sign that it appears it'll be a partisan budget writing process?
Happy to jump in. I would say it's better. Last year was horrible. Made no bones about that. And I spent time as well as Senator King reaching out, trying to mend those fences, trying to get back to where we were. Transportation should be bipartisan. I think the work that we're doing already in the committee with Chair Fye and myself on the budget cabinet, we have similar priorities and goals. And we're seeing that that move ahead plan was not quite as well baked as we thought. There's a lot of work to do there to what Senator Braun just said. I've reintroduced the sales tax bill that I had last year. I think that it is time that we truly consider that for funding for maintenance and preservation. This conference that came up, I think it was timing. Like a lot of things in the legislature, we get things last minute. And I scrambled around to make some adjustments just so I could be there. It's important for us to be there because I want to hear what they're going to say and then be able to have some responses from our perspective. But it is, I would say, John, it is better, Jerry. However, I caution that as we see, as with so much, there's some other agendas going on here. And there's a lot of stuff that's weaving its way into transportation, whether it's climate, and other pieces that are concerning. And I think as we go through the process, if that starts to rear its head, it could cause some back to a little bit more of what we saw last year. My hope is that we don't.
Yeah, I would echo Representative Barkas again. I think they're saying the right things. We'll see how it plays out, but we need this to be a bipartisan process. We need more investment in transportation. We do, and I'll put a plug in for Representative Barkas's bill, we need another source of funding for transportation. And we have an opportunity, even though we're not in quite the shape we were last year in the operating budget, there is an opportunity. Right now, we're in a very favorable position with regard to catching up on our long-term liability on pensions. And if we do that and we do it well, that could lead to substantial kind of freeing up of money in the operating budget that could be, I think, reasonably redirected long-term into transportation. I think that we shouldn't give up on that idea. We know we need, you know, broadly, we know we need a better funding solution. Anyone, I think, on either side of the aisle that looked at the funding for this, for Move Ahead, would recognize that was not particularly well done, but more importantly, not sustainable. You can't do it again. There's no path. We need a better long-term path, and we have one in front of us if we can just come together and work on it.
Jerry, did you have anything else?
No, stop. Thank you.
Okay. Next, we will go to Claire Withicombe of the Seattle Times.
Good morning. Thanks for your time. I actually wanted to ask about the Employment Security Department. My colleague wrote a couple weeks ago that Washingtonians are still having trouble getting benefits and reaching anyone on the phones. I was curious, just in general, whether there's any appetite within your caucuses to increase funding for the department or to otherwise kind of ramp up the resources that they have to provide better services to Washingtonians.
Claire, I think that you'd see lots of appetite to improve services, but one of the problems, and especially improve the function of state government, but one of the challenges with single party government is the team in charge never really investigates itself. It never tries to find what the problems are. The team stands up for itself. When you have a more normal situation where the two different parties trade off from time to time, there's always an incentive to dig into agencies and see if you can improve them, see if you can understand the problems. In my 12 years here in Olympia, under nearly constant single party rule, and certainly the same party in the executive branch, I've witnessed no appetite to try to do that, because the team becomes more important than the function of government, I think.
Any other thoughts on that?
I would just say I agree with everything JT said, but to the question, are we willing to invest in better services at ESD? I think everybody on this call and probably every single member of our caucuses has spent in their offices have spent hours and hours working with constituents to help work through ESD claims. No one is more committed to fixing this problem than the folks in our offices who have borne much of the brunt of trying to deal with these delays from ESD and frankly from other agencies as well. So I think we're game to fix the problem, but we want to really fix it, not just dump more money into money in with no guarantees that it's going to actually get better. We want it to actually get better for the citizens of the state.
If I could ask a follow-up of Senator Braun, is there a specific policy or other approach you would take to actually fixing those problems?
I would say, first of all, it's not just one problem. Some of it was driven by this, giant roller coaster we had, particularly early in the pandemic, and then all the additional federal money, which I think we're all grateful for, but caused a bunch of other issues with regard to fraud and other misuses of the funds. So, and this is kind of, carried on over time. And so that's the problem early on. Right now, the problem is a little different. A lot of the funding that goes into the ESD is formulaic and is driven by federal money based on the number of claims. And as we know, the number of claims for unemployment insurance has gone down significantly, you know, since early in the pandemic. So I think if we're going to solve it, we have to look at some of the things the ESD is proposing, which is kind of a reserve force that they can pull in to catch up when they need it, almost a part-time force that's available as needed. That's one idea that I think has merit as an example, but it's not, I don't think it's an easy, straightforward solution. And back to what Representative Wilcox says, I think as much as anything, we need all the agencies, but in this case, ESD, to be a little more reflective on what they are, you know, on what they're doing well and what they're doing right, and get after the things they're doing poorly. I don't think that's a mystery. They're just response times, as you mentioned, have been very slow, that often sometimes non-existent. And that's when many of our offices, that, as I mentioned, get involved. We get a lot of calls saying, hey, they just won't call me back. And I don't think it's a funding issue when they don't call back. That's just an attention to doing the job.
Thank you.
Have anything else, Claire?
No, I'll let others go ahead.
Okay. The next question comes from Drew Mickelson of King 5 TV, who passed it along to me earlier. That question is, it sounds like Senator Dingra has no interest in the bipartisan House bill allowing police pursuits for reasonable suspicion. She wants to further study the issue before making any changes to the pursuit law. Do any of you see a path for changing the law this session, and why is it needed?
Well, I think it's really concerning that one individual located in one legislative district can make a decision for all the health and safety of Washington State. Our constituency is very concerned. This is a big issue, and the people of Washington State want this addressed. Unfortunately, for one person not to be able to bring it to the vote for the elected officials to represent the people is just very upsetting that person would have that much power. We need to address this issue. Anybody can think of an instance in the last 24 months where their community has really suffered under the policies of these policing bills. We see it every day. And so if we can go to a part where we can talk about the issue, we can look at it as felonies only, and just look at making sure that these individuals, as was mentioned when we talk about transportation or other issues, aren't driving away from these crimes, it would be the best thing that we can do. Law enforcement officers are the safest on the streets. They're not initiating unless it's one of the most difficult situations, but to allow individuals to just leave a scene of a crime, drive away at any time and not be able to pursue is really showing with our crime statistics and what's happening in our communities.
Hey, Drew, one other thing that we can add to I think the basis of your question is, can one person do this? There's 147 people in the legislature. One person absolutely should not be able to do it. And the only way that they can do it is if their caucus empowers them to do that. That's a large caucus. They're used to being in charge. They're used to standing up for the things that they believe in and that their constituents demand. I'm talking about the House Democratic Caucus. It's in their hands. I know that Senate. I know that John and the Senate Republicans would join with any of that caucus to help bring that to the floor. And just because we've got a problem in the Senate doesn't mean that House Republicans and Democrats can't join together. It is silly to let one person in the Senate decide whether or not we're going to run fixes to that bill in the House. And I think the leadership of both caucuses, certainly me, has been very open to making modifications that will make a lot more sense and keep people safer. We should absolutely pursue this in the House, send a bill over to the Senate if Senator Dingra isn't willing to do it, and put some pressure on that body.
Go ahead, Shelley.
I was just going to say, Senator Dingra is citing a study by the University of Washington that other colleagues have said doesn't even there's not enough sampling to make it a legitimate study to actually, you know, go ahead and utilize the results. But that's the information that she is relying upon to you know, put her foot down on any of these bills. There's tremendous bipartisan support for bringing the pursuit legislation back forward, because we, as Representative Maycumber said, we're seeing it throughout all of our communities, the need to have law enforcement have this tool. So again, she's utilizing information that isn't even presenting the picture. Our law enforcement agencies have shared information. Other scientists have shared information. And so I think to study it and then get back to doing something about it continues to put our communities at risk.
I'd like to add just two things quick. First of all, make it clear that the bill in question passed both chambers last year by substantial bipartisan support. This is not going back to the pre-2021 rule. This is a negotiated solution that ensures training and accountability for officers, but also gives them the authority to pursue based on reasonable suspicion. This is a negotiated solution. I'm comfortable that if it was presented on the floor of either chamber today, it would get strong bipartisan support. Whether it's and the other thing I would reinforce what JT said, certainly Senator Dingra needs to be held accountable for her unwillingness to even hear the issue. That should be unacceptable. But make it clear that she serves at the pleasure of her caucus. If her caucus says we want to hear this, they are in a position to do this. So as you talk about this, it shouldn't just be Dingra's holding it up. It is the caucus that's holding it up, and it's caucus leadership in the Senate Democratic caucus that is willing to stand behind her when it's not clear to me, based on discussions with some of the other members of the caucus there, they're quite so willing to let her do that. We'll see how this develops over the next few days and weeks, but I think that there's a strong group of folks in that caucus who are committed to addressing this issue in a realistic or in a thoughtful way, and that we're not done yet.
And I would like to finish up by saying we have an Eric Robertson pursuit policy that would fix this issue, and also an Alicia Rule policy in the House. Bipartisan support have signed on. We have Republicans and Democrats that are willing to come together.
All right, next we'll go to Alexandria Osborne of the Washington Newspaper Publishers Association.
Oh, sorry, I don't have any questions today.
Okay. Jerry, coming back around to you, did you have one final question that you wanted to ask, I think?
Well, yeah, I just wanted, because it's not directly legislative, but it's been an issue. COVID has, is the policies coming out of the Federal Drug Administration are likely to change in the very near future, recommending annual boosters, creating a system which probably many thought were going to happen anyway, like flu shots, and that'll be their recommendation. I wondered if anyone has any thoughts about that transition and what, if any, changes that should bring to how state agencies operate in dealing with COVID and boosters going forward.
Well, I would say that regardless of what the feds do, that State of Washington should bring that back to people that were fired. We talk all the time about failed function in our executive agencies, and a lot of it has to do with workforce. Now, I'm afraid that a lot of people wouldn't want to come back, but I think there could be a lot of healing done if the governor would invite those people back and let them know that we need them.
And just reinforce what JT said. We saw bipartisan effort at the national level, which is not so common a thing, right? Around stopping the F policy in the Department of Defense, where they sent people home because they wouldn't get the virus or get the vaccine, rather. I think, you know, we should recognize that this is an important issue, and whether the policy is the same as the flu shots or not, I think that people, as long as they have the ability to make a decision for them and their families, then that's just fine with me.
And I think that, Jerry, that's key. individuals need the ability to decide for themselves what works best for them and for their families. And so it shouldn't be treated any differently than you know, someone getting a flu shot. Again, their decision. I think when it comes down to school children, I think parents ought to have that decision. Look, we're going to continue to, you know, our own systems will continue to evolve as COVID is here and staying here. But we need not go the direction that we have in, you know, in the early part of the pandemic. I think we need to allow people to make that decision for themselves. And I would hope it would go that direction.
And I would like to jump in on this. We saw recently where WSU lifted the mandate on vaccines for volunteers for the 4-H program. We lost a lot of volunteers because they were parents, grandparents, neighbors of these 4-H students. And now they have lifted that and made it a recommendation only. So we're going to be able to start back on those programs that we have lost so many folks that support those programs. So I agree, recommend, but no mandate.
All right, in closing, I would just like to throw it to the leaders for any last remarks. Representative Wilcox.
Thanks, John, and thanks all of you. There was a little bit of a common theme here. It was questions about performance problems, I think, in state agencies. Question that we finished up with about COVID. We've been through an unprecedented time. It doesn't matter who's in charge. People would have made mistakes. This is a good opportunity to go back and fix a bunch of them. We talked about fixing our COVID mistakes. We've talked about fixing our law enforcement and pursuit mistakes. We didn't talk about mistakes that were made in drug enforcement, but we all know that those were made too. Let's just get together and do them.
Yeah, I just want to thank everyone for being here. You know, we're going to stay focused on what we think the top issues, but there's lots going on. I think we talked about we're going to make progress on public safety. I really believe we're going to get this figured out on Blake. We're going to get this figured out on pursuit. We're going to get figured out on how we get more officers on the streets, on affordability. There's lots of things going on, but as I said earlier, the most hopeful, I think, is in housing, where there's a lot of positive work being going on collaboratively. The one where I don't think it's getting enough attention yet is K-12. We're working hard on bringing that to people's attention and really working to get after this learning loss and get after the structural funding for a K-12 system. But we'll stay focused on this issue. It doesn't mean we're going to focus on the other issues. But in this effort, you know, you got to put your first things first. And we think those are the first things.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.